It's very clear that the operations team is under a hell of a lot of pressure.
Can you mic on?
Oh, sorry. So yeah, absolutely. So our parent company, Deutsche Bahn and Arriva, have provided additional management and operational support to our business. Obviously, the team that we have is effectively geared about, you know, turning around the issues, getting the day job right, so providing additional operational support to get the planning right and the reviews right going forward. That's been key. And I'll be honest, we have you know, spoken at length with colleagues from Deutsche Bahn. They've been over and they're all taking an active part in the review that we're doing, and we'll take an active part in the review that's been done independently. So, you know, we're not just in this ourselves, we are looking to our wider organisation for support, and that's being provided.
Cool.
Thank you, Chair. Woeful, 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 a woeful performance and the way people are being treated. How do we trust an organisation that when it announced the franchise for the Southport service was actually so paced it couldn't be, people couldn't realise it weren't getting the Piccadilly connection? When I took a motion through Sefton Council, supported by all the other parties as well, and a member of that is here, and gone to the city region, and we've asked for something to be done to maintain the service. And you're well aware of this issue, because we've been talking about it for some years. As we've gone through that process, at the beginning of the year, we had David Brown here, and he spoke to this committee and was duly recorded to the research and responded to what I asked him to continue with the service as it was until any changes come in. That was a yes and a yes. We're seeing so much opaqueness and obscurity on what's going on. We wonder how, whatever's being said from an organisation now, can we trust? You've had, I believe you're well aware of it, you have a business case brought to you by the user groups for that. You've not really seemed to have had any reactive response from yourselves in that to continue with that value service into Piccadilly. We've lost an airport, which TfL has said that is one of the main economic drivers to actually have of that link, and that's taken away. So what I would like you to say to me, bear in mind, it is recorded, and I'll be coming back and reminding everyone at every occasion that I can of what's being said. Will you continue with a service that's improved on what's now? And notwithstanding the fact that what you said is, you will not look at any change in December. I think this needs to be made an exception. If you're not accepting that business case, can I have from yourself or somebody else in authority to give me a written response of why that business case doesn't work?
Yes, that's good. I think just to pick up, in order, I want to go right back to the start of the franchise, but the most recent timetable change for the Southport services was consulted with Opster and SRTF, and the plan that we put in place was to operate initially two peak time services to and from the south side of Manchester from Southport. That was delivered this May. We have read and met with Opster and SRTF 2 weeks ago. And I personally commended Alan and Eric on their great piece of work that they've developed. I think I followed that up with a letter to them, which effectively says that the Northern are committed to continue to work through the working group that I formed. That will involve both ourselves, Northern, SRTF, Oxter, Rebel Partnership. We're looking at a number of step changes to enable an increase in the on the current offer. So we are looking at adding another peak time to and from the south side of Manchester. Given the release, press release from Transport for the North this week regarding the timetable effectively rolling forward, we need to have a look at when that additional service could be introduced on top of the current two services in the morning and afternoon. But our long time aspiration is fully aligned with all members of the working group, Oxford and SRTF particularly. Our aspiration is to resume and return an hourly service to the south side of Manchester from the south of Bournemouth. May 19 will be the biggest opportunity to make the most significant changes, and that's been briefed by the working group to Oxford and SRTF. And we will be reconvening the working group to discuss what elements and improvements we can make between now and then.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Craig, for your presentation. You outlined in your presentation the detailed compensation you propose to pay people. But monetary payments go only a small way to compensate the residents and the businesses vested in the Liverpool City region by the terrible service they experience from your company. But that said, have you considered freezing any price increases you have scheduled for January? Surely that would be seen as a gesture of goodwill and the people affected in this region by your company's failures.
Thanks, Sue. You're absolutely right. I can only apologise for the terrible service that our customers, communities and water travellers have faced since we introduced the timetable in May. I outlined a compensation package which touches on direct compensation but also the marketing element. I think that second marketing element, which is going to be led initially by the local authorities and the tourist boards of those regions, we will be doing our own separate marketing which will align with that and support it. So there'll be two streams. Part of that, I think for me, is getting people back on rail sooner rather than later, so we can see that the service is recovered and it's reliable again. I think to do that, we need to make some offers before that. So I've asked our marketing teams to look at what we can do with ticketing in advance of any major ticketing time change. I think if we wait until January, I think that's probably too long. So doing something sooner rather than later, I think, is the key.
Can I just come back on that, Chair? I think it's really good to see that you are looking at something now, and I think that's only given the failings as I've outlined. But I do think I would ask you to look at freezing prices in January, because obviously January we will be looking at increasing them. So I think it would be a gesture of goodwill to do that, as well as having the financial as well.
Yeah, that's noted. I think the other industry process is a lot of the fares that are increased from January are not increased miles. It's effectively department. But the industry is well aware of the issues that have gone on and the challenges that our customers have faced. So I think, I would take that back to our business personally. And I think it will be a discussion for Transport for the North at some stage in the near future as well.
You would do that, and as I say, normally you would be asking me to do this. If no service, our people are faced, I think it would be seen as a gesture.
Yeah. Chris.
Michelle. Craig, I'd like to take you back to a comment that you made relatively early in the presentation. It kind of intrigued me a little bit, and that was that once Network Rail had informed you that the engineering was going to be delayed, You then sought to delay the implementation of the proposed change to the timetable. Can you give us a bit more detail on why that was refused, and sort of who that discussion took place with around delaying that?
So yes. So yeah, I talked about the magnitude of the timetable change and some of the damage it would take to be general. We realised that we had 3 or 4 months to do that, which has never been done before, probably never will be here. We made representations to the industry quite early on. As I said in the slides, that was rejected. It's not our decision to make, but and the reasons for that, I wasn't party to those, but I think if you look at the industry as a whole, the May timetable was a massive change for all operators in the UK, and for those operators, they were very, very keen to deliver their improvements. A lot of those operators are, more sort of intercity type operators who have longer distance journeys that cover the whole of the UK, and the way the network is connected, those train services need to be planned first, and then the regional services drop in around it. That's how planning generally works, and that they simply need those services to remain as planned. So it's not what we wanted, but that was the decision.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Craig, for that update. It's appalling, really appalling, in terms of what's happened. And if what I've read in the newspaper, some people's job were under threat. So while, we sit here and we hear what you've said, they're real people who've had a really devastating impact because of this. If I reflect on my journey, 2 days I had to go to Leeds for a meeting, and on both days I got there late, 3.5 hours late. I changed 3 trains. At one time, within 5 minutes of sitting on the train, we had to all get off. There were people who had train journeys to connect to Manchester Airport. Well, their journey went out the window, basically. And what I noted, you mentioned there were people calling you, texting you.
Yeah.
Well, good on them.
Yeah.
When I was at the platform, there was nobody in management, nobody there to even give information. So, happy days that people have your number, but in terms, there were nobody visible to give any information. And I think that was so poor. This real-time display, it was showing that the train was coming or 1 minute late. And, no train ever showed up. So for me, in terms of the reputation of the railway, has been really dented. It suffered such a catastrophic blow following the past couple of months. How will you seek to repair this proactively? Because I've listened to what you said, but in terms of you're dealing with real people who've been affected here, how would you, repair that as soon as possible to attract people back? Because a lot of people are going to be put off and take their cars, and we all want people to get on the train, in terms of reduced congestion. But after that, people are going to be put off. So that's my first question. I'll let you answer that, and I'll come back.
Yeah, and absolutely, it's vital. I think for me, first of all, as I keep saying, is to get stable and reliable service back in. So we've got something that we can market, and when people do return to rail, it's something that you can rely on and can trust again. I appreciate people, have taken a decision to use the cars or the transport modes. And it's important that we track them back through a number of ways, and one is obviously reliable service, two is through joint marketing with the local authorities and what we do ourselves, and that's digital, or the whole host of the marketing strand. So we've got digital, online, posters on stations, as well as ticketing and you know, offers, special offers. But you can do all that, and if you haven't got a train that's reliable, then you know, you can give as many offers as you want, and people will not come back and stay, you know, on rail. So we need to do it in a sensible order. So let's get the train plan right first, let's make it reliable, and we can promote that jointly with local authorities and local tourist boards. We have a huge database of our regular customers, and we'll be contacting each of those direct via email, and as well as, you know, providing offers, we have the compensation scheme just to, you know, to demonstrate, you know, how serious we've taken it and how, you know, upsetting we realise it's been for a lot of people, particularly those who rely on it to get to work. So those are the two keys, three key strands for us.
Just a point of clarification, you said that you know, for people who have taken the decision to use their car, they haven't taken that decision, it was forced upon them. So I think you should understand it was forced. People would not take their car to work if they had any other option. In terms of senior management, because as I said, when I was at the platform, I saw nobody. Can you tell me how many senior management, Northern management, senior staff were deployed in terms of giving information in terms at the time, because as I said, I saw nobody.
Yes, I don't have the figures for the whole business, but I can comment on the West region, which is the region I manage. We have a various offices scattered around the Northwest, and when the disruption was occurring, everyone who worked in an office was sent out to the platforms to give out information and assist our station colleagues. This was both on stations and on trains. We talked about social media earlier. We double manned and extended those hours so we could try and get accurate information out to customers via social media. We do have a limited resource, and you know, we were appreciative of colleagues at Network Rail. And Virgin Trains and Transpennine also assisted. Obviously we have over 476 stations, so we had to focus our staff where we'd be the most use. And in my area, that was the Lime Street, Pret and Preston predominantly.
Would you come back with those figures, all the figures, please, so we can, because it's okay to say certain areas, but in terms of looking at the whole area where people were affected, it should be evenly distributed. So would you agree to come back with all those figures for us?
So the figures you'd like is what management presence we mobilised on front line effects?
On every platform.
Any further questions before I ask you? Yeah. Four from myself, if I may, Craig. I'll try to take them in a bit of a kind of chronological order when we think about the kind of crisis that we're hopefully emerging from. Obviously, the main root cause of this was to do with Network Rail's inability to deliver infrastructure enhancements on time, and kind of real house of cards effect that has had by that failure to do that. One of the things that I think we've always been of a united voice on is the fact that Network Rail needs to be structured in a fashion that actually focuses on infrastructure delivery in the north of England. And one of the things that I know we've collectively called for and was vindicated by its inclusion in the Shore report is a northern route for Network Rail. That was refused by Chris Gray, and we were told we were going to have mitigating structures, including a sort of director level position that would be looking over Network Rail infrastructure in the north, and a couple of what you would call stakeholder boards. Neither that position has been fulfilled, nor have those sort of stakeholder boards actually been set up. is it now not the right time for us to say, no, that isn't good enough, we need that northern route? And how are northern absence of arguing back into the Department of Transport to say, in terms of infrastructure delivery, it has to be completely different, and we need something that isn't as soft to the north, something that's focused on the north. How are you doing that at the moment?
Yeah, thanks. Can't really comment really on decisions regarding network rail structure, but I do agree it's vital that they have the right resource at the right levels to engage in with both local authorities, Transport for the North and the operators such as ourselves. One thing that we put in at the very start of this franchise was a Northern Network Rail Alliance. And this is the senior board members from both organisations meeting to discuss issues that are affecting our ability to run trains, mainly through programme delays in infrastructure. I think it's fair to say, since the May timetable was introduced, that alliance has ramped up significantly. And it's not just a case of, you know, senior managers in a room, you know, discussing future projects and perhaps reviewing things that haven't gone well. This is managing directors from both organisations having very detailed reviews and working together to ensure future plans are delivered robustly. So that arrangement, and it's not just Northern TransPennine involved in that as well. So we've got the right people in the room, but I think that needs to be developed more and continue to be carried out.
Well, that magnified resource, that's great, but I hear what you say. Obviously, that was the largest roof corps, which is beyond your direct responsibility, but the areas that you are responsible for is particularly the standard resource. And retraining drivers is not something you can do in a couple of hours. You know, that's a very detailed process which is actually kind of defined by some legislation ultimately. Why didn't anybody raise the flag? Did they? And it wasn't heard. Was it at a junior level it was raised and it didn't kind of filter up? Did it get to a higher level and it wasn't then raised back to the DfT? Why didn't anybody do that? Because bluntly, when we read your franchise agreement, technically that's an area you could be in breach of contract on, rather than failure to inform the DfT and the Rail North Partnership. You might not be able to fulfil the service through trade and resourcing.
So, I guess there's two elements in terms of train crew resourcing. We plan a staff plan that looks 2 years in advance, so we can break that down into individual train crew depots. We recognise and we knew exactly what we were going to be doing in terms of additional services right across the north. And we had a staff plan, recruitment plan, and training plan geared around the specific milestones for sort of May, December and May again next year. We've actually recruited over 160 more drivers than we had at the start of the franchise, more than we've ever had before within this franchise. But I do take the point regarding, you know, the adjustments to training plans, our reaction to the delays in the infrastructure. I think the biggest issue for me is you know, where we have delays, we do tend to get told about it further in advance, so we can there's enough buffer in the training plan to adjust that. I think the fact that we were advised at the last minute, effectively for Blackpool, and very late on in the process for Bolton, to change that plans, to change the training plans, and then deliver a robust timetable in that short time, if I'm honest, is impossible. We did have that conversation with the client, around the partnership at the time, I guess the lessons have been learned from that. And I talked about the Glacier review before. That's going to be critical in ensuring that infrastructure providers and train operators really get their act together when they're planning major investments and timetable changes, and the programme has resilience in it.
So we are where we are, and there's a lot of lessons that we'll have to learn. We're currently in a period of emergency timetable that's meant to be drawing to an end, literally 3 weeks out, July, October. Is it definitely going to be in a position that you will be able to fulfil the true May timetable on July 29th? Because, and when I say sort of being able to fulfil that, I don't just mean the physical timetable, I mean it being resilient enough to be punctual, reliable, and sufficient capacity. Because one of the problems we have is a lot of shortfall that we're aware of, that technically the trains run, but people are placing like Lee Green and Earlstown that haven't physically been able to go onto the train. When we get to the end of July, will you be able to deliver that? Because I would much rather that someone within Northern has the balls to say we need another month now, rather than kind of go through the same, lead us to the top of the hill and frankly we'll come crashing back down again on July the 30th, 31st and the 41st and so on. So where are we up to the LSC?
So I touched on the drive train for the two big chunks were Blackpool Preston and the Liverpool Lime Street Ring signalling. Both those elements of training will be complete. There are other bits of training going on elsewhere that we need to review. We are doing a huge amount of work now to, as I mentioned in the presentation, to review any residual risk on a line by line basis. So we're reviewing the training plans, which have gone really well. We're reviewing how we reintroduce those services, and we're reviewing what the impact will be to the resource of the roster plan. That's a piece of work that we're doing now this week. And we will not reintroduce the timetable where we fail, I can assure you of that. So we will make a decision on the 29th. One that is well customers and we will share that with TfM in due course. Your point about rolling stock capacity, yeah, absolutely, this is a massive issue. When we're running two car trains in the peak, it's not sustainable. The fact that the electrification through to Blackpool is now complete allows us to be more efficient with our rolling stock resource. So where we've had to use a mix of electrics and diesels, we're just using electric all the way, releasing the diesel for elsewhere. So in terms of the rolling stock requirement, we will be okay for the 29th. The next big piece of infrastructure which allows us to bring back a lot of the diesels that were cascaded elsewhere is obviously the Manchester to Preston leg of electrification. We're told that will be complete this December, so that will give us an opportunity to put our units where they needed to be, so that will give us more unit resource in effect going forward.
Okay, so by the end of the week, I presume we'll hear one way or another. Obviously, the May timetable was a big step, but it was a step on the journey of continuous service enhancements. The next step was meant to be December, and only a couple of days ago the Rail Delivery Group announced that for Northern Transpennine we were going to roll over to the May timetable, roughly speaking. I think one of the things we'd be really keen to understand is that in a bit more of a granular fashion, because if it's the December enhancements are too much of a big bite to chew, then we wouldn't want to repeat the kind of chaos of May. However, if there are increments that people make, particularly things like additional Sunday services, which effectively is just rolling across sort of the enhancements of 6 days the rest of the week, are the means in which we can sort of look at some enhancements in December, particularly with yourselves. I think the other piece of work linked to that, we would want to understand, because obviously if that's going to lead to a reprofiling of service enhancements across the sort of franchise time period, then we want to understand that a lot more depth and detail. If there's something that's not going to happen in December, will it be next May? Will it be the following December? What is the knock-on impact? Because whilst we don't want a kind of a repeat of what's just happened, by the same token, we don't want to kind of say, well, there needs to be no further improvements. Because amongst other things, they are franchise obligations. One way or another, they have to be delivered. So we need to understand in a timely fashion.
Yeah, Yeah, you're absolutely right. We have what's called a train service requirement, which is effectively a contract to run X number of trains on a certain route between this time and this time. That's very, very specific, and it is associated with specific timetable changes. The roll forward of May will primarily be to fix the issues with the timetable and get a better balance of services, particularly to the major centres in the peaks. We don't know what that looks like just yet, and we don't know if there will be an opportunity to add in any extra services of a significant proportion. However, as with all timetable changes, we would consult with Mersey Travel, as we always have done, in good time, and absorb that feedback. The last thing we want to do, as we've just said, for the 29th of July, we don't want to be in a position where we're failing again in December. And it's important that the timetable that was rushed in is properly reviewed and reintroduced almost in December, so the service is stable, resilient, and passengers can rely on it. So one other thing, all of the improvements that we've outlined many times at this committee to be delivered by 2020, all those improvements, all that programme of work, everything that we're doing with new trains and stations, all of that is still on programme to be delivered. We're not removing anything, so I just want to be very clear on that. The £1 billion of investment will happen.
Okay. Jeff.
I must admit today you've been really trying to answer as many questions as possible and lost. You haven't answered them certainly. One of the things that was mentioned earlier was to describe the perfect storm. I'm sure some travel public will see it's more of a fiasco. We're asking you, your management team, the way you've gone about handling this fiasco. On a rating of 1 to 5 and 5 being the highest, where would you rate yourselves of how you've gone into this and managed it?
So I guess if 1's been the lowest and 5's been the highest, if 1's been the lowest and 5's been the highest, I think it is varied depending on which portion of the timeline you look at. So if you look at before the infrastructure delays were announced, I think we're probably at 4. When the infrastructure delays were announced and our reaction to that, we went down to a 1, maybe 0. The recovery plan and reaction to the main timetable failings, I think, was a 4. I think beyond July the 29th, we don't need to drop behind a 4, we need to be at a 5, and a continual 5 going forward. So timetable delivery, very, very poor. The way the industry has developed that, the planning process is under review, and we look forward to the recommendations to ensure that we are at a 5 going forward. But those recommendations will be very granular, and there will be action plans for each of those, both for Northern Network Rail and the wider industry.
Okay. There's no further questions or comments, obviously. Thanks for a very thorough presentation and very simple and thorough and honest assessment of the questions and what you've answered, Craig. I'm sure you've been able to kind of pick up from this sort of forum, as you will have done from many different locations right across the area in the past few weeks, the sort of concern, frankly the anger and sort of frustration that people have felt around this whole issue. If I can ask that, obviously, all those bits that we've asked you to consider that you do take away and do give us responses to, and obviously, if there's a time you can return back to us, that would be appreciated. But very much, if we can thank you for your attendance and what you've done today.
Thank you.
Okay, then, if we move on to some of the reports that then follow. We've got the Mersey Ferries update report as item 5, and I think Gary's going to present this one.
Hi Anne, thank you Lee, good afternoon members. Just to walk through the first of the report, is to complement the next item on the agenda that looks at quality and performance around our various key modes, and that looks in more detail around action levels and so on. Just the purpose of this report is just to provide an operational update around our activities at Mersey Ferries and make sure we update members too on our interventions and our actions around Mersey Ferries' longer term strategy. To go through and just summarise some of the key highlights in the report, sections 3.3 and 3.4 tease on some of the actions that officers have undertaken in the last 6 to 9 months around problems and technical faults that we suffered on the service during the last 2 years. Those members present on the committee last year, you'll recall, we suffered a number due to the age of the vessels and the need to regularly invest in them. There were a number of unplanned technical failures on the two vessels during our busy summer months, and officers have been carrying out a range of detailed analysis around those technical failures and interventions we can bring in the short term of the existing vessels to improve service levels for our passengers. And section 3.3 and 3.4 summarise some of those activities we've undertaken. And I won't report on it fully until end of year, but what I can say is already in season so far we've seen some benefits associated with that moving forward. And I'll report fully on that in future performance reports. Section 3.5 hopes to highlight some of the efforts again the team are doing behind the scenes around a range of events programme for Mersey Ferries, recognising really that in effect as 3.4 says, if we can have the boat on the river on a Friday and Saturday evening to improve the technical performance, it also presents us with an opportunity to generate additional income. And for 2018 we put in place a range of quite detailed and probably our largest cruise event programme for the year. And we're learning very much by that. So some cruises that we probably feel may not have been as popular have sold out, and others that we expected to perhaps be really popular haven't. So it's very much a continual process. We're learning from the customer feedback on those. And we can say just already today, just as a headline figure, the Manchester Ship Canal Cruises, as an example, we're at an 80% occupancy level already for the year ahead. So a lot of those are booked in advance and really popular. We've had the conversations before we come into the room. And the Beatles tribute, the Beatles theme cruises themselves, one this coming weekend and two later in the year, are almost sold out. 3.6 summarises some of the events that Mersey Ferries does in recognising our efforts in the community. There's been some successful events with a widow-based commemoration of Jack Potter and his family, and we also recognise annually things around the Z Brugger and the recognition of the role the Mersey Ferries plays in such a key event, and it's lovely to see lots of the members represented at those events too. Later on in the report, from sections 3.10 to 3.12, we touch on a lot of the activities particularly active around procurement processes, some of the key interventions associated with their long-term strategy. So 3.10, we can say a prior information notice has been published and made available through the OJU, the official journal of the European Union, just to promote the fact and warm the market up. It is our intention to purchase new vessels moving forward. And as part of that notice, we actually had a supplier engagement event yesterday, and that was attended by over 40 suppliers from the maritime industry, both locally, nationally and internationally, just to understand what that programme will look like, what our intentions are, and the timescales associated with that. So what we consider a really successful event just yesterday. And 3.12 talks about our efforts still to find a long-term future for one of our vessels not in current use, World Daffodil, and there is a call for expressions of interest from interested parties who may be interested in looking at long-term viable options for Royal Daffodil moving forward. The deadline for submissions closes tomorrow, so hopefully there'll be a number of submissions for us to consider moving forward. Section 3.14 talks about the work the officers are undertaking around seek and landing stage and our options on what we do for our future. Particularly the issue on seek and landing stage is the two bridges, both of which have been identified are coming to the end of their life. So we need to consider options that potentially be fair to renew those bridges. There's been a range of workshops and activities behind the scenes to identify the best option before we bring it back for a recommendation. And finally, 3.15 talks about work officers are doing along with colleagues in Wirral Council to ensure that Wirral's plans for the potential the wood side, longer term regeneration options link in to our long term basic strategy too, and we identify where we have worked together we're able to do so. But it is to stress that currently the strategy assumes that there is no budget available at this point for the renewal of Woodside land estate, which has got a very limited lifespan associated to that moving forward. So there's a key decision we need to continue to work with our local council officers. There's a key decision becoming more and more festive for the organisation. I'm happy to take any questions.
Any questions or comments? Steve?
I mean, great big report, a lot of positivity in it, particularly about the new boat or boats. Whilst it is a competitive tendering exercise and all the rules and things that go along with that, we are on the verge of an example of what a firm can do locally. I think today Nattenborough is being launched tomorrow, and that was a vessel built of a bespoke design, and I'm pretty sure local firms could engage in that process and hopefully be successful, and that's a really positive thing. Do you have any sort of criticism? It talks about the style being used in the project as along the lines of the Rolling Stock project. And of course, the Rolling Stock project did focus very heavily on the trains and the design of the trains, but it also focused on the infrastructure around that. So you can't have a decent train and rubbish stations. You can't have a bespoke vessel without bespoke landing stages and issues that go along there. So it brought to mind that we did last about a year and a half ago, perhaps maybe longer, we had this debate and we distinctly said as members we wanted a three-terminal strategy that included Seacombe, Woodside and Liverpool. This report reads like a two-terminal strategy and just leaves the Woodside issue very much up in the air. Now, we're all adults, we're all grown up. You know the budgeting implications may be more difficult for one or two or three of those alternatives. But if members' will is to be expressed and taken on by officers, then it should continue throughout the process and not sort of a course of action be taken that leads members down an opposite way or a different policy. So my view is that this report is good and does encourage dialogue with what's going on over at Woodside, but it's not holistic enough. It doesn't look at the whole issue of infrastructure. As I say, we have two boats on the river. We may well need a three-terminal strategy. We might have something down at Woodside in the future, with ambitious plans. Whittle Growth Company, by the way, if anyone's not heard of it, is the biggest single investment procurement exercise that in the country that is currently taking place. It is literally a massive, huge project that we'll have engaged in, and I'm sure they would be interested in engaging with us. So, my view is that it's great in all the things that it talks about, but it isn't truly a three-terminal strategy, and I would ask for the officers to go away and come back with another report that does look at a three-terminal strategy, warts and all, problems and all, and I think that would stimulate debate around short-term issues around all land stages and the vessel and everything that goes with that. You could also look at other funding sources. So if you don't know what the amount of money needed is, how can you then look for the relevant funding sources? So you need the whole picture. And I certainly would encourage dialogue with Wirral Council and Growth Company and other partners, as you know, and people don't know. Woodside Terminal, there is